Can you come closer?
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. My brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is the first lecture of our new series, inshallah, which will take us some days to complete, and it will be weekly, every Wednesday after Maghrib, بإذن الله تعالى. And basically, the series is called Fiqh al-Usra, which I chose a name which is Love, Marriage, and Divorce. But in reality, we're talking about the family. The family is the first brick in a Muslim community. And if it is sound, then the community will be sound. If it is not, then the community will not be sound. It's exactly like the heart in the body. And we have to admit, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that we are having serious problems at our homes. Because when we got married, we did not know how to go about it. As a matter of fact, let me say this, we did not know that the religion has a say about it. A lot of people, lack of knowledge, lack of understanding about the religion of Islam, subhanAllah, which teaches us how to go to the bathroom. Our religion teaches us how to answer the call of nature. You think our religion then will ignore such an important thing in our everyday life? Absolutely not. If you check the Quran, you will find the Quran, once it comes to the salah, for example, the Quran says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the salah. Then the sunnah came and explained how to pray. When it came to family issues, the Quran spoke about it in details. Marriage and divorce. We have a whole chapter, the second longest chapter in the Quran, called the women. It talks about marriage and divorce and how to go about it. We have a whole chapter called the divorce in the Quran. So our religion provided ways to form the family, provided ways to live as Muslims within that family. But because a lot of us are not aware of it, then we go ahead and adopt other ways. And this is the result of this. We have what we have. Families breaking apart. Divorce rate is high in the Muslim world. Every 6 minutes in the Muslim world, there is one divorce. In the Muslim world, we're approaching the same ratio of non-Muslims. We have a serious problem. And I'm telling you, for us to reform the Ummah and come back, we have to begin from there. Winning an election, having the House of Speakers is not the solution. The solution, how can we reform our Muslim homes, inshallah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, normally, before we begin, I am to explain the title which I chose. The title is made of three words: love. What I meant by love really is the duration of engagement, the time which comes before marriage, that you start developing feelings for the opposite gender. Islam has a say about this too: what you can do and what you cannot do. We're going to explain this. How can you actually propose, and who you can propose to, and who you cannot propose to, and how should a father handle a marriage proposal according to the Sharia, according to the deen, with evidence, and what the proposed, what would they call the fiancé and the fiancée, something like that, what they can do and what they cannot do. This is love in reference. I'm hoping this love will continue on during marriage. But our religion tells us that is not necessary. Love may disappear after the first, second, third year of marriage. Then another thing emerges called rahmah, mercy. وَمِنْ آيَتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً. This is love. وَرَحْمَة, mercy. One of Allah's signs that He made for you from your own selves, mates, spouses, where you find peace and tranquility, second. And He placed between you both love and mercy. So basically, Islam is telling you, if love disappears, then be merciful with one another. This woman still your sister. This woman still your sister. Be merciful to her. This brother still your brother. Be merciful with him. So, but the ideal thing, that love continues. Love carries on after marriage. But I'm telling you, let's be realistic. In a lot of cases, it does not. Now, there are some boundaries for a husband he cannot cross. There are some responsibilities upon the husband that he must fulfill. And also, there are some boundaries upon a woman, or for women who cannot cross. And there are responsibilities upon a woman, upon the wife, that she has to fulfill. Regardless. Now we will explain this, inshallah. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, this will take us to the final piece, which is having problems. Marriage problem. Marriage problems. I want to say that the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had marriage problems. If you pretend that you do not have marriage problems in your homes, in your houses, I'm sorry, you're lying to yourself. I'm telling you, the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had problems. But now, how to deal with these problems? How to resolve these problems? How to go about it? And what happened if it cannot be resolved? Who should you go to find the solution? And then at the end of the day, then at the end of the day, if it is not working, possibly it's not going to work, divorce is a solution. But now, when Muslims divorce, they kill one another. Vengeance from one another. No. Divorce. We're going to teach you how to go about divorce with the least damages. I'll never forget this day when some brother called me, and I know him personally in Egypt, and he's asking me, I wanted to go and perform Hajj for my father-in-law, and I know he got divorced. And I said, what do you mean? Aren't you divorced? He said, yeah, but my ex, I mean ex-father-in-law. His ex-father-in-law still likes him. Even so, he divorced his daughter to call him to perform Hajj for him. That means whole a lot. That means when he divorced this woman, he followed the Sharia. He followed the deen with the least damage. Because my brothers and sisters in Islam, like marriage put people together, put families together, divorce destroy these bonds, these relationships. That is why you have to follow the Sharia. You have to follow the deen in how to divorce. Because marriage is the most important of the three words, bidnillahi ta'ala, allow me today to give a little introduction about marriage and the importance of marriage. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it one of the signs for His might and power. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. One of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He made for you from your own selves wives, mates. The scholars of tafsir, they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have made all the children of Adam or made all of Adam's males, and then He would have created, for example, for him females, but from another race, like jinn. But as a matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created from you your spouse. And you read in the books that when Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, our father, was created and he was placed in paradise by himself, he felt lonely. He felt a loner. No one is around him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created from him, from his rib, his wife, Eve, Hawa. And He placed between us mawadda, love, and mercy. Marriage, brothers and sisters in Islam, is actually a bounty. A bounty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala labeled it to be a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nahl, وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَجَعَلَ لَكُم مِّنْ أَزْوَاجِكُمْ بَنِينَ وَحَفَدَ وَرَزَقَكُم مِّنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. And Allah made for you from your own selves spouses, mates. And out of your mates, out of your wives, He given you children and grandchildren. And He bestowed upon you of His bounties. So marriage, as a matter of fact, is a bounty. So if you're married, you should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you're able to marry, you should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go and get married. Marriage, brothers and sisters in Islam, من آكد سنن الأنبياء, the way of all the prophets صلى الله عليهم جميعا. ولقد أرسلنا رسلا من قبلك وجعلنا لهم أزواجا وذرية. O Muhammad, we have sent messengers before you and we made for them wives. Wives, wives, and I'm not going to say more than that, and offspring. Sayyidina Ibrahim had two, Sarah and Hajar, correct? Sayyidina Sulaiman had 100. One day he said, لَأَطُوفَنَّ اللَّيْلَ عَلَى مِئَةِ امْرَأَ. والحديث في البخاري. أهو, رواية أخرى 70. Look at Ibn Hajar, he consile the two. فمن آكد سنن الأنبياء, therefore our messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم told us to get married. But before the messenger, we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also commanded us to get married. Allah commanded you to get married. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ. Marry the ayama, those who are needing marriage and they are not very well off, and the righteous of your servants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, the famous verse that all the men memorize, فَانْكِحُوا مَا طَابَ لَكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ مَثْنَى وَثُلَاثِ وَرُبَاعِ. And you cannot handle one. Marry. Marry. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Hadith Anas fi Sahih Muslim, when those three individuals came to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hadith al-Rahd, and they asked about his manner of worship. Hadith ma'roof, yani, has a lot of benefits, but I'm quoting it just for one thing. Basically, they came to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, three individuals from out of town, and they asked the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how does he worship? What does he do? They explained to him. Of course, they said, sometimes he plays with us, sometimes he actually cooks food, sometimes he, and when time to pray, he leaves. So these three individuals, they said, you know what, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not making enough, is not praying, is not doing enough. أشوف الباب هذا خطير. وكأنه مستقال. And then they felt like that is not good to say about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know why he's not doing enough? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all his past and his future sins. Well, this is even not correct. يعني عائشة رضي الله عنها, when she entered into his room, when he was praying into the her room, when he was praying, to the extent that his feet got swollen from standing at night praying tahajjud, and she asked him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why are you doing this? He said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all your past and future sins, what did he say? أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shouldn't I be a grateful servant of Allah? الشاهد, or the important thing is, one of them said, I will fast every single day. The other one said, I will pray tahajjud every single night. I will spend the whole night, every night in salah. Never sleeps. The third one say, you know those women and children who will occupy me from the worship of Allah? I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to stay as a monk. No marriage. Rahbaniya yani. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say about them? He right away called the whole ummah to the masjid. And he got on the pulpit. And he said, لَقَدْ سَمِعْتُ مَا قَالَ الرَّهْتِ لَقَدْ سَمِعْتُ مَا قَالَ الرَّهْتِ. I heard what these three individuals are saying. Wallahi, by Allah, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ. I am the most knowledgeable amongst you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His attributes and His names. وَأَشَدُّكُمْ لَهُ خَشْيَةً. And I am the most fearful of Allah amongst you. And I pray at night. And I sleep at night. And I fast. And I break fast. And I marry women. وَأَنْكِحُ النِّسَاءِ وَأَتَزَوَّجُ النِّسَاءِ. Rather, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith, he says, حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ مِن دُنْيَاكُمُ النِّسَاءِ وَالطِّيبِ وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. The two things that I love most from your dunya is women and musk, and the apple of my eye, my comfort, I always find it in the salah. فهذه سنة الأنبياء, سنة الأنبياء. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to do it. He actually called upon the youth, and especially right now in the ummah, we have the youth who say, we shouldn't get married now. You know, some young men, they say, let me just play around for a couple of years, for 10, 15 years, and then get married after that. Ya rajul ittaqillah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kama fi hadith ibn Mas'ud, wal hadith fi al-sahihain, addresses the youth, يا معشر الشباب, O youth, من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج. If you're able to get married, get married. ومن لم يستطع, and if you're not able, huh, فعليه بالصوم, فإنه له وجاء. Then fast. Of course, the movies and the soap operas, they tell you take cold showers. Cold showers is not going to help. Okay, if you have that craving for the opposite gender, fasting to do it. Fasting will bring you down. Oh, this is important for our youth to know. This is important for our youth to know. طيب, this is a fiqh question. And هذا الوجيز كله, إن شاء الله. الوجيز بس إيه يعني إيه بندندن شوية حوله يعني. ما حكم النكاح? What is the ruling regarding marriage in Islam? When you ask that question, what is the ruling? What do we mean? You see, any command that we have in the Quran or in the Sunnah falls into five areas. Must do, meaning what? Wajib. You must do, it means wajib. Recommended. What does it mean, wajib? That you're sinful if you do not do it. That you must do it. You have no choice. Mandatory. Recommended. Meaning you could do it. It's up to you. If you do it, you get rewarded. If you do not do it, you don't get punished. There is mubah. It's permissible between. And there is dislike to do it. And there is haram to do it. Five areas. So when I say, what is the ruling regarding marriage in Islam? Here it is. Number one. It is mandatory upon every Muslim who is able to financially and physically, and he's being exposed to fitna because of women. It is mandatory upon this person to marry. If you have the money and if you have the physical strength and you're going around looking at women, maybe going around and because looking is haram. قل للمؤمنين يغضوا من أبصارهم وقل للمؤمنات يغضضن من أبصارهن. That also applies for women. Now if you're able to do this, then you have to get married to protect yourself from the fitna. It is disliked to leave it. In this case, highly disliked to leave it because you're in need for it. It is recommended upon a person who is able to, but he is doing okay with the fitna of the women. Because I want to tell you, brothers and sisters in Islam, and do not deceive yourselves about this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, في حديث أسامة بن زيد والحديث في الصحيح صحيح مسلم, ما تركت فتنة أشد على الرجال من النساء. Oh, I have not left a fitna, a test that is harder, more harder or harder on men than the women. The fitna of the men is the women. That is the messenger. This is what Allah says. Now don't say, no, I'm in control. يا أخي اتق الله يا شيخ, تضحك علي ولا تضحك على نفسك. Don't deceive yourselves. Don't deceive yourself. ده انت لما بتمشي قدامك كده حد وددك بترتفع. يعني when some cougar walks in front of you, your ear moves. تقول لي لا من كنترول, ما ينفع. اهو, the only way for you is to protect yourselves by marriage. So it is recommended for that person who is able to. It is haram and in some cases disliked for a person to marry. Who is that person? Who is not physically fit. And you know what I mean by that. He does not have the ability to have intercourse with his spouse. Unless he reveals that to her before marriage and she agrees to it, that's another issue. That, for example, they just want to be together for, not necessarily for this. But I'm telling you, this, the having the intercourse is mandatory. You must be able to do it in order to get married. طيب, inshallah, in the minutes I still have, I still have maybe 20 minutes. I want to mention 7 benefits that you harvest from getting married. Basically, I'm trying to convince you to get married tonight. If you're not married, if you're married, that's fine. But if you're not married, then I want to and you're able to, I want to convince you to get married. Number one, like I said, the best way to protect yourself is from that fitna, the greatest fitna that basically left for us men, which is women, is to get married. يعني هذا الحديث صحيح مسلم, but understand the hadith properly. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إن المرأة تقبل في صورة شيطان. طبعا على طول they come after you, women is شيطان. لا يا أخي, that's not what the hadith says. Basically, when a woman walks in front of you, shaitan beautifies her in your eye. Makes her beautiful. والحديث الآخر, إن المرأة إذا خرجت من بيتها استشرفها الشيطان. When the woman leaves her house in a way that she's an icon of temptation, shaitan basically looks at her and says, how can I make the best use out of you? Come, walk. And then he would beautify her in your eyes. إن المرأة إذا خرجت من بيتها استشرفها الشيطان. هذا حديث. But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, الحديث في صحيح مسلم, إن المرأة تقبل في صورة شيطان وتدبر في صورة شيطان. That she goes out, شيطان beautifies her in your eyes. And let's say you're married. You desire this woman. You see what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says? فإذا رأى أحدكم من امرأة ما يعجبه فليأتي أهله. If you're walking in the street and your eyes landed on a woman, shaitan beautified her too much in your eyes, go and sleep with your wife. Why? فإن ذلك يرد ما في نفسه. This will help you to kick off that thought. You go to your wife, over. Solution. Right away. How many of us experience this? Come on. Let's be realistic here. Right here. Solution. A way of protection. Right here. Right here. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he commanded us to get married, commanded who? The youth. That desire, by the way, in the youth is the highest. When you grow up, it declines. It fades away. But for the youth, the peak. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he encouraged, he said, يا معشر الشباب, O youth, من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج. If you're able to get married, get married. If you're not able to, then fast. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he described the believers in Surah Al-Mu'minin, in Surah Al-Mu'minun, what did he say? قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ الْآيَاتِ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ. One of the attributes of a believer, that they guard their private parts, that they do not commit illegal sexual intercourse with someone whom you're not supposed to. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya ikhwa, fil hadith al-akhar, man yadman li ma bayna fakkayhi wa ma bayna fakhdayhi adman lahu al-jannah. Guarantee for me two things. What is between your two jaws and what is between your two thighs. I will guarantee Jannah for you. Al-Farj wal-Lisan, ya ikhwa, are the most dangerous tools that you have. Marriage can help you. So the first benefit that you harvest from marriage is you're able to protect yourselves from such a thing. Because listen, Allah fashioned you to desire the opposite gender. Now, the only way for you to fulfill that desire is by marriage. Any other way is unlawful, is illegal, is unlawful in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa zina, adultery, is a major sin in Islam. is a major sin in Islam. That's one benefit. I'm going to quiz you about these benefits. The second benefit, listen to this. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, الدُّنْيَا مَتَاعُ. The life of this world is a temporary enjoyment. Listen to this. وَخَيْرُ مَتَاعِهَا الزَّوْجَةُ الصَّالِحَةُ. And the best of its enjoyment is a righteous wife. والله يا إخوة, the best enjoyment of this dunya is a wife who is righteous and pious, who you go home and find comfort there, that you want to be there, you want to stay there. Oh. يعني الرواية الأخرى بتاعت سنن النسائي الحديث هذا, يعني this wording right now في صحيح مسلم. Another wording, حديث عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص في السنن, سنن النسائي, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إذا نظرت إليها أسرتك. When you look at her, she pleases you. Huh? يعني women now, the wives now, when they are at home, they are like policemen. She's wearing always the kitchen clothes. And when she goes out, she boots the white and the black and the yellow on. For who? You're supposed to be vice versa. You're supposed to beautify yourself for your husband, not for the people outside. Oh. فَإِذَا نَظَرْتَ إِلَيْهَا أَصَرَّتْكَ. If you look at her, she will please you. وَإِذَا أَقْسَمْتَ عَلَيْهَا أَبَرَّتْكَ. And when you take an oath on her, by Allah, you have to do this. She tells you, yes, I will do it. النساء الآن, a woman now, you take an oath on her, huh? She does the contrary. عشان تصوم ثلاثة أيام ولا تطعم عشرة مساكين. In order for you to fast 3 days or to feed 10 مساكين. Just to get you in trouble. No. But الزوجة الصالحة will not do this. وإذا غبت عنها, and if you leave the house, huh? You don't even have a doubt that she will guard you in herself and in your money. She's not going to allow someone to come into the house in your absence, and she will guard your wealth. Isn't that what you want? Isn't that the type of partner who you want? Ya ikhwa, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that relationship between the husband and wife, he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, fi surah al-Baqarah, hunna libasun lakum wa antum libasun lahun. You know what libas means? Garment. They are a garment for you, and you are a garment for them. That means you wear one another. Garment also, it means they veil you. We all have shortcomings. We all have shortcomings. Your spouse should veil you, should protect you, because you're exposed to her and she's exposed to you. Now, we're like garments to one another. Also, the concept of garments, warmth, when you're cold, you find warmth in that relationship. We need this as human beings. You need to understand this. We need this. We need to be able to fulfill that sexual drive that we have. We need to have these feelings at home. So when we get out of the house, we're ready to help the ummah. You know the problem is now, our houses are not like that. That is why you come out of the house troubled, fighting with everybody, because you're fighting at home. But if you find the second at home, the peace at home, the tranquility at home, the serenity at home, you will be able to go outside and fight, not in the sense of fighting, but rather deal with the challenges which you're facing. But what is happening now to us, to a lot of us, that were facing challenges at home. The home is turning into a battleground, and we go outside also a battleground. That is not, we're not feeling that peace. And inshallah, yani I want to stay positive and pessimistic, inshallah. Pessimistic or optimistic? Yeah, optimistic, inshallah. So the purpose or the intention behind that series is to make this happen, inshallah. طيب. Number three, like I said, marriage brings families together. Subhanallah, someone from Palestine marries another person from Egypt. Two families are coming together. Huge. Two blocks are coming together. And subhanallah, Allah mentioned this in the Quran. وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ مِنَ الْمَاءِ بَشَرًا فَجَعَلَهُ نَسَبًا وَصِهْرًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created from the water a human being. And then he turned that human being into basically nasab, relationships. وَصِهْرًا. Subhanallah, you end up marrying a woman and then you end up having the whole family. That's my brother-in-law. And you probably don't know the family. You just got to know the women. But that is your brother-in-law. That is your father-in-law. That is your mother-in-law. Huh? And the uncle. So that's one of the bounties of marriage. يعني القصة المعروفة بين المصطلق. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went to Bani al-Mustaliq, a tribe in the Arabia, and he basically captured the majority of the people there to be prisoners of war. Technically, they turned into slaves. Bani al-Harith. Look at this now. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Juwayriyah. Juwayriyah is one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ummul Mu'mineen. Juwayriyah bintul Harith. So basically all the almost 2,000 of her tribesmen, they are related to her. Now when the companions learned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married Juwayriyah, they said, shame on us to hold family members of the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as captives. Freed them. All of them were freed because of Juwayri bint al-Harith. Why? Because they are related to who? To the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is another bounty that we get out of marriage. Ya ikhwa, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, يعني هذا اللف, this statement is normally said in the tongue of people. الزواج نصف الدين. Getting married is half of the religion. And that really comes from a hadith. الحديث في معجم الطبراني بسند حسن, حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, من تزوج فقد استكمل نصف دينه. Whoever gets married, he has completed half of his deen. What does that mean? What does it mean? That he's protecting himself. That he is not going to commit a lot of haram. He is guarding half of his deen. فَلْيَتَّقِ اللَّهَ فِي النِّصْفِ الْآخَرِ. Then be careful about the second half. فحتى يقول لك إيه يعني in our back home where we come from, يقول لك كملت يعني نصف دينك. ليه ما half of your religion? Why didn't you do half of your religion? Get married. Half. Half. في الرواية الأخرى لهذا الحديث, another wording of this hadith, في مستدرك الحاكم, فقد استكمل نصف الإيمان. Half of the faith. That means the other half is easy to fulfill. Number five, marriage, ya ikhwa, is the only way to have children. Children who come out of wedlock are weak, not accepted in the society. Ibn al-Zina, يعني في رأي, يعني there is, and actually this is the view of the majority of the jurists, that if you have a child out of wedlock, it's not to be related, is not to be named after you. يعني هذا رأي الجمهور. وإن كان رأي يعني the view of the minority is more accepted ويعني واعتمده شيخ الإسلام, but the view of the majority of the jurists, they say that if you have a child out of wedlock is not to be named after you because it's a son of adultery. And subhanallah, how many children now in this time where we live, they come out of wedlock as a result of illegal, unlawful relationship between a man and a woman. Oh, for the only way for you to have a child who will not be harassed in the society, who will not be harmed in the community, is by getting married. Getting married. And having children, ya ikhwa, should be your goal. Yani, they tell you the problem with a lot of the Muslim right now, that if you ask them, why do you get married? Why do you want to marry? They gonna stutter. They are not gonna answer you right away. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu says what? Wallahi inni la arghabu fi al-nikah. By Allah, I do not desire having intercourse with my spouse. Look at Umar. ولكني أكره نفسي على النكاح حتى يخرج من ظهري نسمة تسبح الله. Oh. But I force myself to it with the intention of having offspring who will say لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. Children, يا إخوة, you see, when you produce children and you bring them up as Muslims, you are bettering the future of the Ummah. And this is not only Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Sayyidina Sulaiman, the hadith that I quoted earlier. Huh? What did he say? Hadith al Bukhari. Wallahi, by Allah, la atufanna al-layla. Tonight, I will go around all of my wives, 100 of them. Why? In order to have children who will serve the cause of Allah. Oh, Sayyidina Sulaiman. وَلَمْ يَسْتَثْنِي. He did not say inshallah. That is why it did not work. He got a fetus. Because the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that, وَلَمْ يَسْتَثْنِي. Would he have said inshallah, huh? He would have got the 100 children. But he did not say inshallah. That is why he got a fetus. The intention is to have children. I want to tell you something. The best investment, al-adhan, the best investment that you can make is to have righteous children. Naam, al-adhan, yalla. So the fifth benefit of getting married, my brothers and sisters in Islam, like we mentioned, is to have children. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam actually told us to choose the women who can give you children. He says, تزوج الودود الودود الولود. Marry the women who are loving and childbearing, who can give you children. It tells you also that when you have children, it will lead to love. Sometimes that bond between you and your spouse develops actually after having children, after seeing the produce, after seeing the harvest of that relationship, that you see that child is a result of that relationship, lawful relationship between you and this woman. Children, brothers and sisters in Islam, is the best investment. I'm telling you, if you want to make an investment with Allah, invest in your children. Invest in your children. When you teach your children how to pray, you get rewarded. When you teach them the Quran, you get rewarded. A child who memorizes the Quran will place crown made out of light on the heads of the parents in the day of resurrection. Even when your child dies and you're patient. Hadith in Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the soul of a child of a believer, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask the angels, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, I have taken the soul of the son of so and so. What is he saying? What is he saying? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. But the angels will report and say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabb, he's saying Alhamdulillah. He's praising you. He's praising you, O Allah, for taking his son. Because that is qadr. There is nothing he can do about it. Nothing he can do about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angels, build for my servant a house in paradise. Call this house the house of praise. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi sunan al-Nasa'i, ikhwa, one of his companions used to come and sit with him. And he used to bring his little boy with him. And he used to love. He used to hug him and touch him. And you can see the love between a father and his son. Later on, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam noticed that this companion does not come anymore. So he asked, where is he? They said, O Messenger of Allah, his son died. The child he used to bring with him to your gathering passed away. But when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him playing with his child, he actually asked him this question and he said, أتحبه? Do you love your son? You know what the father say? أحبك الله كما أحبه. شوف. May Allah love you as much as I love my child. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the son away from him. So later on, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called upon him to come back to the gathering. And then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells this father, would you like your child to open the gate of Jannah for you? Then be patient. فحتى سبحان الله في موت الأبناء منفعة. If you're patient. ذاك عندك سفيان الثوري, one of the imams, the thought occurred to him. He had one of his, the only son actually who has. يعني he read this hadith about the virtue of having your son dies and you're patient. So his son is walking in front of him and he says, يا بني ألا تموت فأحتسبك فأدخل الجنة. شوف هو الهدف بتاع الجنة. He wants to go to جنة. سبحان الله, his son died. Oh, Abu Abdullah, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, his son passed away. You know, they ask him, كيف أنت, كيف, how are you feeling? He said, by Allah, أبول دما من الحزن. I'm urinating blood because of my grief over my son. Oh. فيعني they can benefit you in the dunya. Look at this. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم والحديث في صحيح مسلم. He says when you die, you receive no more good deeds. إذا مات ابن آدم أو الإنسان انقطع عمله إلا من ثلاث. The first one is what? ولد صالح يدعو له. Righteous offspring who will invoke the mercy of Allah upon you. فhow are you going to get children? What is the way to have children? Children who come out of wedlock, they are not the way to go. They are weak. But the best way to have children is to basically get married. Brothers and sisters in Islam, marriage is a way to earn a lot of hasanat, to earn a lot of good deeds. في صحيح مسلم حديث أبي ذر الغفاري رضي الله عنه, the poor of the Muslims came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and they said to him, يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, ذهب أهل الدثور بالأجور. The wealthy and rich people got all the reward. They pray like we pray. They fast like we fast. But they are rich. They give sadaqah. So they get rewarded more. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam told the poor of the Muslims, every time you say subhanallah, you get a sadaqah. Alhamdulillah, you get a hasana. You get a hasana. Alhamdulillah, you get a hasana. Allahu Akbar, you get a hasana. You enjoy in good, forbid evil, you get a hasana. Here it is. وَفِي بُضَّعِ أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةً حَسَنَةً. And if you sleep with your spouse, if you go and make intercourse with your wife, you get a hasana. يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, أَيَأْتِ أَحَدُنَا شَهْوَتَهُ. One of us will come and fulfill his desire and he still get a good deed because of it. What happens if he places it in haram? Wouldn't he get a sin? Yes, هكذا. Even when you sleep with your wife with the intention that you want her to be protected, because the wife also needs that. Women also have that sexual desire. Now, the only way for her to fulfill this is through you. So if you have that intention before sleeping with your spouse, you get a hasana. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wal hadith muttafaq alayhi, إِنَّكَ لَا تُنْفِقُ نَفَقَةً تَبْتَغِي بِهَا وَجْهَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا أُجِرْتَ عَلَيْهَا حَتَّى مَا تَجْعَلْ فِي امْرَأَتِكَ. There is no nafaqah. Any spending that you make, any amount of money, when you go shopping, to the store, when you go to the store shopping, you're frustrated, aren't you? Because you're going to end up spending $100, $200, huh? Right? Have your intention that you want to feed your spouse for the sake of Allah. This is a sadaqah. Oh. حَتَّى مَا تَجْعَلُ فِي امْرَأَتِكَ. What you feed your spouse, what you feed your wife, what you feed your children. Even if you die protecting your family, if someone comes and attacks you in your home and you stand for that person to protect your family and protect your wealth, you're a shaheed. الحديث في سنن أبي داود, من مات دون أهله وماله فهو شهيد. Whoever dies protecting his family and his wealth, he is a martyr in the sight of Allah. Number 7 and the last, subhanallah, a lot of us think that when we go get married, it's going to be difficult. We're not going to have money. We're not going to have means. As a matter of fact, and listen to this hadith, al-hadith fi sunan al-imam al-tirmidhi wal-hakim wa ahmad, sanaduhu hasan, thalathatun haqqun ala Allahi awnuhum. Three types of people, they are entitled to the help of Allah. Haqq. حق here, يعني إيه؟ Allah promises that He will help them. One of them, المجاهد في سبيل الله, someone who goes out in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Two, al-mukatibu yuridu al-ada'. Someone who is enslaved and he told his master, I want to be freed, how much? $100,000. Allah will help that person to gain his liberty. Number three, وَالنَّاكِحُ يُرِيدُ الْعَفَافِ. And someone who wants to get married in order to protect himself and guard his chastity. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in conclusion, جزاكم الله خيرا. This is like the first lecture of the series, Love, Marriage and Divorce, like I said. But I want to close by saying, and listen carefully to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the marriage contract in the Quran or described it to be mithaqan ghaliza, a firm and a strong covenant. When you go and marry a woman, that covenant in the sight of Allah is strong, very strong and very firm. As a matter of fact, the only other covenant, the only other contract, covenant means a contract, the only other contract which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given it that description, you know what contract? The contract which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has with the prophets and the messengers to convey the message. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ مِيثَاقَهُمْ وَمِنْكَ وَمِنْ نُوحٍ وَإِبْرَاهِيمَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ وَإِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ وَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُمْ مِيثَاقًا غَلِيظًا. فَبِي كِرْفُ. You need to learn how to fulfill the conditions of this contract. You need to learn how to fulfill it. Because in the day of resurrection, if you're falling short regarding your duties and your responsibilities, regarding the marriage contract, you're going to be questioned and you're going to be asked about it in the day of resurrection. Inshallah, the next lecture, we're going to begin talking about the first part of the series, which is the marriage proposal. Who can you propose to? The etiquettes of proposal. The guardian of the women, how he should respond, what the marriage proposal allows the fiancé and the fiancée to do, basically, and who you cannot propose to. So don't miss the next lecture, inshallah. We're going to talk about al-khitbah, proposing to marry in Islam. Till then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.